You hope you had a very good weekend on Saturday and Sunday. So I hope many of you, I mean, whoever has come on Friday have received their login ID. If you haven't received your password, because I'm checking the password on your YouTube messages, many people are saying they haven't received the password. Is your registered mail ID, is your registered phone number, is your password. Okay, so that's about the login password. People who haven't re received, will be checking again today's registration forms, who haven't received today's forms. If you register your feedback and I have your attendance for today, we will be creating your login ID and password. So this is for the students. I told initially that we'll be giving this login and password only for the students who are coming regularly. So who has come on Friday, we have given this. So let's get into today's class. So as you know, let me show you the screen. As you know, you will be having all your classmate see the courses. Let me share my screen. So you see the screen. As soon as you enter, you will be having a view of this. This will be keep changing. As I said, we will be keeping on adding features to you every day, revealing one feature. You will be able to access new feature. For now, we have created these two. This is where you will be having dump of all videos. So some students who were saying, Baluvaru, we have given this. So whoever gets comes to college, comes to the class every day, you will be having the here is the session link that will take you to the YouTube, and you will be having lesson one link, lesson two link. So every day links will be showed in this CNDS program live sessions link. And then you have here CPP labs. So when you go here into this, every day you will be given new exercises. So you find program to find sum of elements. You'll be also finding program to create Hello World, and then step by step you will be having all the programs as exercises which you will be completing in this. And then slowly we'll also be adding to you employability skills, and you can compare and see how where you stand with respect to your classmates. So if you go into the employability training, you will be having aptitude test, situational judgment test, logical reasoning test, quantitative reasoning test. These are all your 10th class level, so don't worry that you don't have employability training. Taking test itself is training because they are all 10th class level. Even when you go to your fourth year and give aptitude test, or when you go to fourth year and you are going to join MBA or something else, again, there will be same kind of test. Everything is based on up to 10th class math. So that is what you will be having here. So all these things you will be given slowly access. There are lots of other things. There is campus life where you can discuss. There are jobs and events. All these things we will be adding very, very slowly, probably one in every 2, 3 days, and I'll tell you over this session, right? This is about this. Whoever has not got today, fill your form today, only for the students who join every day will be getting. If you don't come 2 to 3 days, then we'll be removing that your login. Okay, so that is about this, and come back to our everyday login. So here we go. There is one. Let me open this. Share, stop share, and. Okay, for some reason, let me again download the PDF. So today's thing is, today's puzzle is even more interesting, and it is a little bit difficult. It took time for me to understand and to show you. So let me warn that beforehand and show that to you. Fine, unfortunately. Share screen. Hope you're able to see my screen. These are our yesterday's and day before's puzzles. And today's puzzle is like this. You have this hourglass. Everybody has played with this. When you're, are you able to see this, guys? Hope you're able to see this.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, all right. So so you have two hourglass. One is 7 minutes hourglass and one is 4 minutes hourglass. So you have two hourglass and you don't have a watch, don't have a timer, anything else. You just know there are two hourglasses. This is 7 minutes and this runs 4 minutes. When you turn it down, the sand runs for 7 minutes in this, sand runs for 4 minutes in it. Using these two hourglasses, you have to tell me when it is 9 minutes. Okay. Say you put 7 upside down and all the sand is completed. It means you have completed 7. As soon as you completed and then you start the next one, it is 4 minutes. Then totally it is 11 minutes. But what you want is 9 minutes. So you have to use combination of both to get your 9 minutes. Turn this, turn that. So you will have to do a combination of both to get those 9 minutes. So as usual, I will be telling it in the end on how to get those 9 minutes using these two hourglass. But then at this moment, I will ask sir to start off his next class. So over to Swaroop. Swaroop, you can take over the class. Okay, Swaroop, let me know once you are ready. We are not able to hear you. Well, let me know once you are ready. Meanwhile, I'll be explaining to the student about this puzzle. So students, did you, I'm just checking your comments. So did you start thinking about this? Seven were once and four half. Wow. Super. That is how you have to think. So students have really started thinking numbers and algorithms. I'm so glad. This is far better than me or anybody from your previous generations. Students have really started thinking in numbers. So how do you do that? So first, initially, what you will have to do is, see, both of them are upside down. Okay. What happens by the time of end of 4 minutes? At the end of, so when you know it is 4 minutes, when the sand in this entire thing falls down, you will know it is 4 minutes. So when entire sand falls down, that means it is 4 minutes, but there is 3 minute worth of sand still there. 4 minutes, at the end of 4 minutes, all this sand goes down means, okay, so entire 4 minutes, this entire sand has gone and you have 3 minutes left here. So what do you do now? You will turn this upside down once again. So when you turn that upside down, so initially there is zero here and four here, but still there is 3 minutes of sand left over here. So zero, four, three, four. This is how both of them are. So by the time this three goes down, So what happens? 7 minutes are done. This three goes down means 7 minutes are done. There is zero here, seven here. However, first four are gone. Okay. So 7 minutes are done. It stands like this now. 7 minutes are done. The seven is here. And 3 plus 3, 6 has gone down. One is remaining here. Initially, 3 has gone down. Again, 3 has gone down. 1 is remaining here. Okay. Now, you go to next step. Okay. So, 7 minutes you have seen, right? This you will turn upside again. And this is 1 minute there. This, what will happen now? So, what happens, you know, in the next step is, by the end of next minute, that 1 minute sand comes down. That 1 minute sand comes down here. And here, how much is there? Only 1 minute goes down. Here, the remaining 1 minute goes down. And 1 minute goes down here. Okay. So, at the end of 8 minutes, there is 1 minute here. And rest of the things are here. So, what you do very cleverly, you turn this 1 minute upside down to get 9 minutes. So you got 9 minutes. When you turn just that 1 minute, instead of waiting for entire 6 minutes to fall down, you have just 1 minute. And 1 minute again turn upside down. You get cleverly, you do that. You at the end, then you will get 9 minutes. Okay. So hopefully you got this. It is confusing. So don't worry. Again, at the end of the session, once more I will explain. Okay. So over to Swaroop. Swaroop.
Hi, good evening, everyone. Hope you enjoyed your weekend nicely. So, so last session, we have seen some basic programming and what types of data types and everything. So now, today we'll start. We talk about preprocessors. Okay. Today we'll start talk about preprocessors. So let's start. What exactly happens when you write a program, right? So where you write a program, sorry for the inconvenience. Let's start the thing, sessions. See, what exactly happened when you write a program, right? So we have something where we write a program. So if we are, hope you are all are using code block, right? So what is code block? What is C, Turbo C? What is Borderland C? All these are something, but where you write a program environment. These are called environments. So we call them as integrated development environment or IDE. Okay. What exactly IDE will consist of? A IDE will consist of an editor where you write a program. For example, so this is code block. It is an IDE basically. So here you are writing a program, right? So this is called editor. This is basically editor. So a IDE will consist of an editor. It will it will consist of a assembler or a compiler. Then it will have a output. So a ID consists of a editor, a assembler or a compiler. Okay. So what is SDK? How many, can anyone type what exactly, can anyone tell what is simulator? Can anyone say what is simulator? Anyone can type what is simulator? Okay. Simulator is, how many people know Sachin Tendulkar? Oh, most of the people know Sachin Tendulkar, right? Can anyone give me feedback whether my voice is audible or not?
Your voice is audible.
Thank you. So what is a sim? Everyone knows Sachin Tendulkar, right? So Sachin Tendulkar, when he play in a physical manner, right? In a video game, so what exactly a video game is? A cricket video game. A cricket video game is a software code which replicates Sachin Tendulkar, which replicates cricket game. Okay, the Sachin Tendulkar who is there in the game, is he really a Sachin Tendulkar? No, he is not a real Sachin Tendulkar. So what exactly he? So he is a simulated version of Sachin Tendulkar, who look like Sachin Tendulkar, who play like Sachin Tendulkar, whose physical dimensions in a game are very similar to Sachin Tendulkar. So simulator is nothing but a software code which replicate the original person or a system. Okay, so that is what a simulator is for. Okay, what is emulator? Emulator is a replica of a original system in a hardware point of view. So how many of you people, I will tell the same example of Sachin Tendulkar. Sachin Tendulkar has a wax statue which is there in London Museum. There is a wax statue of Sachin Tendulkar. But he really is a Sachin Tendulkar? No, he is not a Sachin Tendulkar. But he is physically, the height of Sachin Tendulkar is physically similar to Sachin Tendulkar, his expression, the face and everything, where you can go and touch physically, is a Sachin Tendulkar replica. So emulator is a device, a physical device which replicate the original system. So we know what is the difference between simulator, emulator and an original system. So we have something called SDK, software development kit. So software development kit will have a ID plus a simulator with some other features. We call it SDK. Okay, those are called SDKs, like Visual Studio, the Java development environment. All these things are SDK, which are called software development kit. A software development will consist of IDE, a simulator, and simulator and some other features. Someone is saying it is Kohli statue. No, we have Sachin Tendulkar first one, then later the Kohli came. So it is an example. So I hope you understand what is SDK, what is IDE. So now whatever the ID, which is the code block, is an ID where you're writing a code is a editor, where you're compiling, you're running the code, that is a basically a compiler or an assembler, and we are seeing the output, and it has an inbuilt debugger. So that is what you're writing now in an ID. Now what exactly happening inside the ID? What exactly is a compiler? So let's check what exactly is a compiler. So what compilation, when you build it, see most of the people have downloaded the code block and might have started using it, or code block or any software code. What exactly happens inside it when you run a code, when you build a code? See, the compilation process consists of basically four contents. Okay, it consists of a preprocessor, the preprocessor, what exactly is preprocessor, we're going to talk. Then we have a compiler, then we have an assembler, assembler or a compiler, then we have a link editor. Okay, so let's see step by step what exactly a preprocessor is. So preprocessor, the role of a preprocessor is to make program to make the program run, it has to make something ready. Okay, so all those ready functionality is taken care by preprocessor. See, on interview point of view, it is very important what role a preprocessor do, what role a compiler do. If you don't understand this thing, it is very hard for, it will be very difficult as a programmer. At the same time, in the interview point of view, it is a very important question to understand. It is very important to understand what is the role of a preprocessor and what is the role of a compiler. So preprocessor first job is to include all header files. Like in a program, we have included hash include studio plan, studio.h. Say, or the studio.h is a header file which is included using a hash fan. So this part is done by preprocessor. Okay, this part is done by preprocessor. Okay, then we have something called macros. We talk about macros later in the sessions. So macros are nothing but a small code which are written before the main. Small code or small declaration which are defined before the main program. So anything which is declared before the main program is basically is done by preprocessor. And preprocessor also removes the comments which you write. Like for example, when we have written the hello world, in the example we have given this is a C, this is a hello world with the black slash star and double slash. All these things are will be removed from the removed, and it will be only the main program will be given to the compiler. So all this removing of all the other thing is done by preprocessor. Okay, remove the comments and everything. So what is a compiler? Basically, compiler is also a C program which is doing the main process of your code running. It will compile, it will check what are the whether the given syntax is right or not. All these things will be taken care by compiler. Whether how exactly the code will be moving, all these things, the compiler is nothing but which is translating your C language into a .obg file or .assembly file. Okay, so this is C compiler. And there were so many C compilers are there in the market, but GCC is the basic, the mini form of commonly used compiler. Okay. And what is assembler, right? So see, previously we used to have machine language is zeros and ones, right? After that, there is a language called assembly language, which is in between C programming and machine language. We call it as assembly language. Okay, so we have assembly language, assembler also, which convert assembly language into object file. Okay, C linkers. The main function of the C linker is whatever the memory blocks you are giving, all these things has to be attached to the main program, right? When you're saying int a, I said when you in defining a variable a, so it is allocating a memory. So that memory, where it is there in the memory block, it has to be attached to your program. Okay, so that link is done by C linker. Basically, it is also a C program itself. Okay, it is also a program. See. So what exactly it happens? Let's see compilation process. So first editor, you are writing a program. Okay, then we do parsing. Then preprocessor will come. What exactly preprocessor will do? It will include .h file. It will remove all the the comments and everything, and it will define the all the macros, everything which are defined before the main, all these things are being done by preprocessor. Okay, then the compiler, the data will be given to the compiler. The compiler will compile the code and check for any errors which are systematic, which are synthetic, syntax errors, all these things it will check and run the program. Then it will, this C compiler will translate into assembly, and there will be assembly language, assembler, which converts this assembly language into a machine understandable language. Then the linker will come. This linker will attach the memory which is there, which is defined there, will be linked, physical memory will be linked to it. So then we have, which is also including a standard library also. Okay. See, what will be the output of an editor? So the output, the editor will be stored in the form of .c. Okay. The compiler will give .i file. It is all happening backside. You don't see all these things. This is what exactly is happening. The editor will .c file. Editor will give the, we're going to save the file in .c. Then the compiler will go give .i file. Then assembler will give .esm file. Then the object file is given. This object file, this is the output of a C program. Okay, when you generate a C program, it is in a form of .obj. Okay, so now you understand what exactly is the compilation process and what is C, what is SDK, what is IDE. Hope you understand what exactly is a, hope everyone understand what exactly is the compilation process is all about. Okay, first the editor where you write the program, then the preprocessor will do addition, the adding of header files and header files and the macros. Then the compiler will compile the program, check for the syntax and everything. Okay, there are basically three types of errors which are there in a C program. One is syntax error, one is syntax error, then is the logical error. So these are the errors which we have. Syntax error is visible, where when you run the program, if you have written any problem, any code which is not described in C program, it will give you an error and you can't run a program till the error is rectified. Okay, then there is a logical error where the code and syntax is everything is fine, but you're not getting a desired output. Okay, so this desired output will be if it is not getting a desired output, so there is some problem with the logic of the program or something which is not, you're not in a position to write. That is logical error. This logical error has to be rectified by the programmer itself. In compiler, we also have something called inbuilt debugger. Debugger, as the name suggests, bug is nothing but an error. Okay, so debugger is the process, is a thing which is helping you to remove the bugs systematically. So that is a debugger. Okay. GNU assembler is a type of assembler which is pre-programmed. Like for example, you have cloths of different brands. Like similarly, we have assembler which are developed by individual developers. So GNU developer, GNU assembler, GCC some compiler, TCC compiler. These are the different types of versions of a compiler which are sophisticated in some other one or other way. Okay, so this is what the compilation process is about. Okay, let's go to where we started on Friday. So go to C program. So GNU is a version of an assembler which is developed by some other people. So assembler is a program, is a translator which convert a assembly language into a machine understandable language. Okay. Hope you got the answer. Okay, let's start with the program. This is the program which we have done on Friday. This is the place where we stopped it. So now you understand what exactly the compilation process is that. So this part, the hash include stdio.h, this part is done by preprocessor. So this part is including effort.h file is done by preprocessor. Okay, the main is from where the compiler will compile the data. So here what exactly we are doing, we are declaring the three variables. We are printing A, printing B, which are stored at the address of A. We are storing the scan data which is we are entering into A, and storing the data which is there in B, and we are printing the value which is C, where C is nothing but addition of A and B value. So all this, why it is percentile D here? Because we are mentioning that the data which is there, which is A, B and C, is a integer type of data. So that's why the parsing is nothing. The format of getting this thing is percentile D. Okay. So this is the example of a typical program. So there is something called data conversion. See, semicolon is used, there is no specific reason why semicolon is used, why is it is a Dennis Ritchie, he has developed, when he developed in C program, he mentioned that every sentence should be, will be ended with semicolon. Okay, why there is a full stop for English, we don't have any answer for that. No? Similarly, it is there, there is no very specific reason for that. So don't bother about those things, hopefully. So data conversion, what is data conversion? Basically, data conversion, we're going to talk about data conversion when we have typedef. We're going to talk about typedef. So basic thing, what you have to understand here is that whatever the format which you are mentioning LHS side should be equal to RHS side. Okay, so whatever the format you have in your LHS, it should be equal to your RHS. Like in your physics, you know that whatever the units which are SI units has to be, if right hand side is SI unit, the LHS also should be a SI unit. Similarly, in C program also, we have to convert, we have to make sure that LHS what is declared is similar, should be there with RHS only. Okay. Example, int A is 3, int B is 2. Okay, but we are saying C is equal to float. So we have to convert this value to this integer A and B to float. Then only the answer will come. Otherwise, we are not going to get the desired answer. So that will be come into a logical error. So the error will come logical error. So let's check if what happened if we do. Let's check what will happen. See, I'm saying it is float x, okay? So let's do some small program. We are defining that program only int A comma B and comma A comma B, okay? And we are saying float C is equal to A plus B. Okay. Now let's save this thing once, and we'll build it. Okay. Now we are going to run it. See, I am saying A is equal to 4, B is equal to 5. I'm saving it. So what should be the output here? The C should be 9, right? Let's see whether we are getting that or not. We're getting the value. Okay. Now I say divide. We're compiling it. So what will be the value? It is not the desired float. Okay. So we are saying float So we are converting the int A to float. So see, now you're getting the desired output. It is 0.8. Now you get why it is important to convert LHS into RHS. Hope you understand that. Okay. Let's go to the presentation. So that is called typecasting. So we will talk about that thing in another session. Let's do some skill check. Let's check what exactly by using a increment and decrement function. Please everyone be attentive. It's very important. Please understand this. We're checking what exactly the output of the following program will come. Okay. So this is the program. Okay. Main, we are declaring int A is equal to 2, int B is equal to 2, C is equal to 2. Can anyone please type what is the value of C, what is the value of A, B, and C after this program? So B is nothing but plus plus A, and C is nothing but A plus plus. So tell me the what is the output of, what will be the output of A? So what will be the print A? What are the values which will be printed of A, B, and C? What are the values of A, B, C? B is 3, okay. 2, 3, 2. Okay. Someone is saying 2, 3, 3. Okay. Okay. A is 2, B is 2, C is 3. Okay. Do you want to check the answers? See. Check the answers. The output is A is 4, B is 3, C is 3. Why? See, when we say the initial condition B is equal to plus plus A, which is pre-increment. So what is the value of pre-increment?
Okay, students, anybody who hasn't got your email IDs, there are two cases. You got email ID and you didn't get password. So you will be getting your email ID, password, and also link to access today. So everybody who hasn't got your email ID, your logins, please make sure you fill your feedback form. The feedback form will be given at 8:15 p.m. towards the end of the session. fill in the form and you will get the, so don't panic, don't worry. If you are sincere, we acknowledge and it is all good. So today you will be getting, so don't worry about it. Even if you are not able to log in also, it's fine. We will be making a small group where you can give your issues. Okay, so don't worry about it.
So that is the most questions, please everyone concentrate, don't worry about logins and everything, it will take care by the team. Okay, everyone listen to the class first, that is important. Okay, don't panic about the passwords, login IDs and everything, but the team will take care of that. So output A is equal to 4, B is equal to 3, and C is equal to 3. How it is happened? Okay, let's check. See, when A, so we saying B is equal to plus plus A. It is a pre-increment. Okay, so pre-increment means the when we are completing the statement, after that only the value will be changed. So value of A is 2. So B will be A plus 1 now. So B value is 3 now. Okay. A value is 3 now. So C is nothing but, so now the value of A is converted. It is A plus plus A plus 1, right? So value of A is also changed now. See, not only B, the we are saying we are adding 1 to the A itself. We are not saying we are when we say plus plus A, it means A is equal to A plus 1, right? We have seen the previous session when we talked about increment and decrement values. We say plus plus A or A plus plus is nothing but A plus 1. But what is the difference between plus plus A and A plus plus 1? Is the when it is going to change. See, if plus plus A, it will be changed after this command. So the value of A after this is 3. So B will be 3. Now A is also 3. So after this, what is the value of C? The C is A plus plus. Okay? A plus plus. So the A plus means now the value of A is 3, right? The value of A is 3. Now it is plus plus A, means 3 plus 1. But these 3 plus 1 will work only when it is, so the value of C is not 4 now, it is 3 because it is post increment. So value of C will be 3 only. After this statement, the value of A will change to 4. Okay, here it is, the value is A plus 1, which is at the time of before this statement is completed, the value of A is converted to 3. But it is post increment. So after this statement, the value of A will change, not before that. That's why you got A is equal to 4, B is equal to 3, and C is equal to 3. Someone is saying, so I have to go slow. Right? See, we have initial value of A is 2. We have initial value of B is 2. Initial value C is 2. Okay? We are saying that after this one, the second line, B is equal to plus plus A. It means 1 A plus 1. Okay? It is a pre-increment. So 1 is added before the termination of this colon, this state. Before the statement, the 1 is added to A. So A is equal to A plus 1. So A value changed to 3 now, which is stored in. So B is equal to 3 now. Now C is equal to A plus plus. It is a post increment. So post increment functionality is that after this line only the value will change. After this line is executed, then only value of A change. So value of A is 3. So 3 will be stored in C. So C value is also 3. But after this statement, we are printing the statement after this line. So this value has to be added, right? 1 has to be added. So A value is A plus 1 now. Okay. So the output here will be 4, 3, 3. Hope everyone understood. So what this is the example of pre-increment and post-increment. Vicky Vishnu, hope you understand what is the value of what is 4, what is 3 and 3. Because why it is becoming 4? Because after 3, this operation has to be completed, right? It is post-increment. After this statement is done, then only the value of a change, which is 3. 3 plus 1, it is 4. That's why it is 4. Hope you understood. Now, let's check some more example of pre-increment and post-increment. Okay. So now tell the int value is 4, b value is 2. So c is nothing but plus plus a plus b minus minus. Please tell the answer. What will be the answer after this code? Please type the values of A, B, and C. See, PDSR, B is, see, everyone is now. See, I'm explaining again, please understand, it is very important for you people to understand what is pre-increment and post-increment. Pre-increment means before the start of any, before when you're saying pre-increment, you are incrementing the value of A from 1. So A is equal to A plus 1. It is not C is equal to A plus 1. It is A is equal to A plus A, or A plus plus is nothing but A is equal to plus is a plus 1. Okay, it is a plus 1. When this result will come is depend upon whether you are using a post increment or pre increment. If you are using a pre increment, the value will be changed at that line itself. Okay, in that line itself means when you are writing this code, b is equal to plus plus a, the a value is 2, so 2 plus 1, the value become 3 in this line itself. Okay, in next line, c is equal to a plus plus. So now the value of a is 3. So 3 plus 1 should come. That should be 4. But it is post increment. It is post increment. So the addition of a is equal to a plus 1 will happen after this semicolon. After this only it will done. After this statement, after a plus plus is done, then only the increment of a will happen. So that's why c value is also 3. Now the a is 3, but this has to be completed, right? After this statement, it has to be completed. So a is 3. So 3 plus 1. So our value will be 4. Hope everyone understand why it is 4, why b is 3, and why is c is 3. So how many people got the answers of this thing? By using same logic, please tell what is the value of C, what is the value of A, what is the value of B. So, so many people are saying 6, 5, A value is 5, B value, so A value is, someone is saying 5, B value, someone is saying 1. Similarly, also tell about what will be the values, the same continuation. This program itself is continuation. So what will be the C after this one? After this one, what is the value of A, B, and C? After this one, what will the value of this equation? What will the value of C after this? Write those also. Please mention what is A, what is B, and what is C. Please mention what is A, what is B, and what is C. 517. Okay. Let's see what exactly is the answer. So first one, A value is 5, B value is 1, and C value is 7. How it is happened? See, when you say A plus plus, the value of A is 4. So now it has become 5. Now B value is 2, which is post increment. So it is 2 only. So 4 plus 2, the value, it is 4. So it is pre-incremented by 1. So the A value become 5. So 5 plus B is minus minus. It is post increment. So B value change only after this statement. So it will be 5 plus 2. Though C here, C become 7. Now the A value is incremented by 1. It is 5. Now the B value is post incremented. So 2 minus 1. So B become 1. That is the how you get A is equal to 5, B is equal to 1, C is equal to 7. Now, here the C value is B minus 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 of A plus plus. It is also post increment, this is pre increment. So the, here the value is 1 minus, here the value is 5 plus 1, that is 6. So 6 minus 1, the answer is minus 5. So A is equal to 6 because it is converted to 6. B is minus, it is post increment. It is 1 minus 1, it will be 0. And C is minus 5. Right? Got? B is not 2 because it is decrementing. How it will become 2? We are not incrementing B value. We are incrementing only A value, right? Repeat once, okay. See, I am repeating. Here the initial value is A. A is 4, B is 2, and we are finding C. C is equal to plus plus A. It is a post increment. So the A value is A plus 1. So now here the value becomes 5. It is post increment. After that, plus will be there. So B is 2. See here, B minus minus we are saying, right? B minus minus we are saying. So B minus minus, it is decrementing, but it is a post decrement. So value is 2 only here. After this statement, B minus, and B is equal to B minus 1 will happen. Before that, it will not happen. In this statement, it will not happen. So here the value is 5, 5 plus 2. So the answer will be, so C is 7 here. But A is 1, B become 1. Okay. After that, C is equal to B minus minus. So B is already 1 now. So it is also a post increment. So B is 1 now. Because it is post increment, there will be no change at the runtime. After that, it is minus. So it is saying it is posting a pre increment. A plus plus. Plus plus A. So it is 5 plus 1. That will be 6. So 1 minus 6. The answer is minus 5. Okay. But B is post increment. It is post increment. So B become 1 minus 1. So B become 0. Now it is. So answer is A is equal to 6. B is equal to 0. C is equal to minus 1. Clear? Let's check how many people have understood. We'll see. Tell me what is the output of this program. What is the output of this program? So what is the output of this program?
What is C? B is 27. Okay. So let's check. B is 27, C is 27, A is equal to 4. Okay. So let's check what is the answer. A is 8, B is 125, C is 125. Oh, 33 will come. See. Let's do step by step. Let me explain you step by step. So A is initially 2. So A value is 2. So we have B is 2 and C is also 2. So B is equal to, we are saying C. Here we are saying plus plus A, cross plus plus A, multiplication of. So in this statement, A value is incremented to 1. B value is incremented to 1. Before this one, let's check what is there. C. So C, this is called precedence rule. So now check, after seeing this, tell me the answer. So first in C, pre-increment will happen. So whatever there in the statement, first pre-increment or pre-decrement will happen. After that, mod will happen. We have the calculation, the sequence, this is called precedence of C program. So pre-increment first, what are the pre-increment has to happen? First pre-increment or de-increment will happen. So that will be given first priority. After that, mod is given the second priority. Then divide, then multiplication, then addition, then subtraction, then assignment. Then last, we have post-increment and post-decrement. Okay. And it also has left to right. It will happen from left to right. If all are same, it will happen left to right. Now, tell me whether it is true or not. See, I'm explaining. See, we are initializing 2. As per the precedent rule, as the precedent, how the program has to be executed. B is equal to plus plus A. All these are pre-increment. So first, all pre-increment will happen. So A value is 2. Now A is equal to 3. Then this statement will come. So 3 plus 1 is 4. Then 4 plus 1, 5 will happen. So now the value of 5. So all the value of A is 5. So now 5 into 5 into 5 will happen. Okay. Got it. So first pre-increment, all the pre-increment will happen. So how many times it is a pre-increment happen for A? It is happening 3 times. So 2 plus 1 is 3, 3 plus 1 is 4, 4 plus 1 is 5. After that multiplication is happened. So what is the rule here? We are saying first pre-increment happened. After that only multiplication is happening. So 5 into 5 into 5. So that's why the value of B is 125. Got? Now value of A is 5. No? We are seeing C. C is equal to, it is post-increment. It is post-increment. So please understand, it is very important. It is post-increment. It is A plus plus into A plus plus into A plus plus. So it is a post-increment. So what is the sequence in which the post-increment has to happen? It should happen last. After all the operation, then only the post-increment will happen. So now the value of A is 5. So it is post increment. So first multiplication will happen. That is 5 into 5 into 5. Then the value will increment 3 times. The value of A will increment. So C is 125. After that, the value will increment 3 times. So 5 plus 1, 6, 6 plus 1, 7, 7 plus 1, 8. So the value of A is 8, value of B is 125, value of C is 125. No, it will not happen 3 cross 4 cross 5 because we are saying it is the increment has to, it is pre-increment. It is pre-increment. Here, see, it is pre-increment. Pre-increment is coming, pre-increment and pre-decrement is coming first. So that's why we have to use first, we will increment A value by 3 times because 3 times it is come. Plus plus A plus plus A plus plus A. So it is 2 plus 1, 3, 3 plus 1, 4, 4 plus 1, 5. So 5 into 5 into 5. That's why it is coming 125. Okay. Because it is a post, it is pre post increment, the value of A will not change at the time of the execution. It will be common 5 into 5 into 5 because it is a post increment. After this operation, the value of A will change, will increment 3 times. It is now A become 6, A plus 1, that is 5 plus 1, 6, 6 plus 1, 7, 7 plus 1, 8. So now the value of A is 8, B is 125, C is 125. Hope everyone understood the logic of C multiplication, mod and everything, right? Hope everyone understood. Varaprasad, you are saying right, but increment will happen once because it is before multiplication. It is before multiplication, the value, see, you see the sequence here. It is pre-increment has to first taken care. So all the increment will taken care first, then the value of multiplication will take care. No, why B will be 60? There is no way B can be 60. See, it is 25 into 25, 5 into 5 into 5. How it will become 60? That is what I am saying. It is post increment. It will be incremented. All the increment will be of A will be taken care of first. Then the multiplication will come. Okay. This is the GCC compiler's process. It will done in this process only. Okay. So now calculate the output of this program. See, it is A is equal to 6, B is equal to 2, C is equal to 12. Now tell what is the value of B. See, so use this rule, pre-increment, pre-decrement, then mod, then divide, then multiplication, then add, then substitute, then assignment, then post-increment. And it is from left to right. This also should be known. It is from left to right. See, why it is not incremented 2 times big? Because plus plus, we have previously told that when we say plus plus A, it means A is equal to A plus 1. That is the meaning of plus plus A. We already found out, we already told about that thing. Wait, I will show that slide. See, so count plus plus, when we say count plus plus, it is a variable plus plus, it means count is equal to count plus 1. So it is a post increment. So it will be used after, it will, the increment will happen after the use. And post pre increment plus plus count is equal to count plus one. It will be done before use. Is that clear? Mr. Sheikh, I think you got your answer, right? Let's go. Now tell me the answer of this thing. Now tell me the answer, how exactly. So you have to see here from left to right. So B will be divided by A. So first B will be divided by A. So B value is 12. So 12 divided by 6. The answer is 2. The resultant is 2. Then 2 is divided by 2. So answer will be B is equal to 1. So that is from left to right. Okay. Now tell me what will be the output of this thing. Now tell me what will be the output of this thing by using precedent. So and see here, the bracket will take the, now it is from left to right only, but bracket will take the priority. The prior bracket will be given the priority. Okay. Now tell me what will be the B value. Everyone is saying B is 1. No, see, so A is 6. So it is, bracket is coming here. So 6 divided by 2, C is 2. So it will be 3. So 12. So here it will be 3. So B is 12. 12 by 3, it is 6. So answer should be 6. Answer, so 12 divided by 3, it is 4. Sorry. So answer is 4. Oh, right. Everyone is good. Very good. Nice replies. Good. Now, one more check. Now tell me what is the value of this thing? What will be the output of A and B? What is the value of A and B? Tell what is the value of A and B? Please don't execute this problem. Try to solve it by yourself first. Then try to execute those things. First, tell me the answer. First, execute. See, bracket will come first, then post increment, pre increment, then multiplication, then addition, and it should be happen from left to right. So let's see the answer. So B is 48, A is 5, A is 28, oh, A is 4, B is 20, So how it has happened? See, so as we said, the first thing we have to do is pre-increment. So A value is 3, so it will be 4. Okay, A value will be 4 here, because there is no pre-increment of A again here, so A value will be 4. Now, before multiplying, you can see it is a C is also pre-incremented. So C value become 3. So now 4 into, so bracket in bracket is given the first priority. So this will happen first now. So 4 into 3, it is 12, right? 12 into 3, because C value is 3 and this is 12, it is 36, okay? Then the A value is 4, 4 into 3, 12. So 36 plus 12, it is 48. Now, A is post incremented. So A value is 4 now, which will be incremented after this statement. It will incremented by 1. So now the value of A become 5. Hope everyone understood. If anyone wants to explain me again, please, I will explain again. See, first pre-increment will happen. So all the pre-increment will happen. So pre-increment are A and C are the pre-incremented value. So A value is 3. So A value become 4 here and C value become 3. It is 2. Initially it is 2, it will become 3. After pre-increment, you see bracket will be given the preference. So first bracket, it is 4 into 3. So this will happen first. So 4 into 3 is 12. So 12 into 3. This 12 into 3, 38 will come here. Okay. It is post increment. So value will be not change here. It will 4 into C value is 3. So it is 12. So 12 plus 36, it is 48. After this operation, the A post increment will be incremented, which will why the value of A become 5. So that is B is equal to 48, A is equal to 5. Hope everyone is clear. It's clear. Okay, let's do. So hope everyone is clear with pre-increment and post-increment, all the mathematical proceedings has to be taken care. Please remember, first thing as per the rule of proceeding, first thing will come is pre-increment and pre-decrement. Please note down everyone, pre-increment, pre-decrement will come first, then mod will come, then divide will come, then multiplication will come, then add will come, then subtract will come, then assignment will come, last it will come post increment and post increment. Okay, and it has to be taken from left to right. Okay, but if you have a bracket after pre-increment is everything, pre-increment only the bracket value will come into picture. So bracket will be from left to right condition, from left to right condition, we have to take, if bracket is there, we have to give the preference to bracket first. Okay. Is everyone is clear? No, Gopichand, the value of A is changing because there is a post increment. So value of A will be 5. Okay, clear? Now we go with another section, which is called selection structure. We have to select while doing program. We have something. We have a program. When we do program, we do some selections. So what are those selections on? Let's see. Okay. So it is selection between, if something is happening, if it is not happened, if one condition is true, then do this thing. If that condition is not true, then do some other action. So that is called selection structure. So it is nothing but logical expression. We use logical expression for this one. Or say logical expression, we have only two condition in this in any programming language, whether the expression is true, whether the expression is false. If we have true, then do that program. If it is false, it is we will do another, that is we do another action. Okay, so selection structure we have in C programming, there are selection section, we call it if. So if you please remember, whenever I am saying something, all those things are part of C keywords. All those are parts of C keywords. So we have called if, else if, and else statements. So what are these statements are? So if is a single selection statement where if you give a condition, if that is true, it will the what you have, if that is happened, what it will be the that function will work. Okay, when if you say if else structure, see if else structure will be having two selection process. If one is there, if this happened, do this thing, otherwise else will come. Else is another keyword, else another function will be. And we have something called if else if. If another, it is a nested. If you have number of conditions, if you're checking one, checking two, checking three, checking four, all this will come into all this. At that time, you use if else if continuously. That is called nested loop or multiple cases, multiple or nested if else structures. Okay, how this thing has been given? Okay. How you have to write a if statement. If we have to do the logical expression, whatever the logical expression you want to check, see in this thing there is no semicolon. If statement will not have semicolon. Please remember this thing, it is very important. If don't have any semicolon to it. Okay, after if statement is if is done, then you write a what will happen if it's true, then that statement will have a semicolon. And similarly, you have this, these are the structure of a C if else, that is selection structure. If else, if this expression is true, do this thing, else do this thing. Else will not have any semicolon. If it will also don't have any semicolon. Okay. This is a simple program where we're going to check the use of if statement. See, here using stdio.h, we are pre-processing it. We are adding a header file. We are maintaining a main. Why int? I will tell you later. Meanwhile, please understand till when the functions will come, we will understand why int is coming. The structure of function we will talk at that time. It will understand why the int is there. You can write, if you don't want to say anything, just put void main. Okay, void main, this is the main program. Start with flower bucket, declare and define the variable. So we are declaring int a is equal to 1, b is equal to 2, c we have to is the variable declare. Okay, we are saying if a is greater than b, put c is equal to a, else we are saying c is equal to b. So we are saying c. So we are saying here, if a is greater than b, if it is true, put c will have c value in a. If it is false, then c value become b. Hope you understand what is if, what is else, where, what exactly. If statement will always hold, or else statement will always hold only logical operators. There are logical and logical operators will be available. Okay. Okay. So this is the simple if else statement. We have nested, we have syntax for if else, we have number of nested loops, okay? For example, here, if this expression is true, print this, else, another logic we are going to check, then if that is true, do this thing, else do this thing, okay? Hope you understand. So this is a, see, in if statements, there is no semicolons. If else also, we don't have any semicolon. If also, else also, we don't have any semicolon. Okay. Someone is saying, go slow. Hope I'm going very, very slow. This if, I'm explaining again, if else statements, that is nested if else statement. If this logic is true, execute this statement. Else, check for another logic, checks for other expression. If it is true, print that statement or execute that statement. Else, execute this statement. So, this is the example of if-else statement. Okay, so we are saying int a, int, we are declaring int a comma b. See here, semicolon is there. We are asking for a value of a and b. We are using scanf. See here, percentile d, which is linked to address of a, and percentile d for linked to b. See, it is separated by, see the structure of scanf, it is semicolon, colons are there before the comma, and we are giving address of a, address of b. Where this value, what are you wondering, where this value has to be? First value has to be stored in a, second value has to be stored in b. So now we are checking, if a is smaller than b, print this thing. Okay, we are printing this thing. If else, check another time, if a is equal to b, we say we're going to print this statement. Else, we are going to print this statement. So this is the example of if else structure. Hope everyone is clear. See, clear screen is a function which is used to clear the screen. When you run the program, you want to clear the screen. So that is where you're going to use clear screen function, which is defined in studio.h. Okay. So we are done with today a simple if else statement increment. So Radha, can you take?
Yeah, okay. So yeah, students, most of the questions were around your login IDs. So many login IDs are being created and being sent to you via email. So do not worry at all. Today fill the feedback form, and all the people who have filled the feedback form today will be getting login password and also the link at which you will have to launch the system. And also tomorrow you will be when you log into the system, we will be giving you one or two exercises and will request Swarup sir to show you how to execute program in the system. So tomorrow first we will show you how to execute the program in the system. Some students were asking how to run the program in the system. So that they will show you tomorrow morning. So no worries at all. Every one of you will be getting the username and password to the system. Okay. All right. Thank you. Have a great evening and see you again tomorrow. Thanks. Bye-bye.